So welcome to our Frank Talk here with best-selling crime fiction author Chris Hammer. Before I begin, just want to acknowledge the Bunurong people of the Kulin Nation, who are the traditional owners of where we gather today. I pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging, and I extend this respect to any elders of other communities who may be joining us here. Chris, welcome to Frankston Library. We're all very excited to have you here. I'm going to fade in and out, so please just stop me if you don't hear something that I say, because it's in and out. We were just chatting about you cruising up and down the East Coast with the new book, The Tilt, that I was very lucky to get an advanced copy of and read in about 2 days straight. Couldn't put it down, and if you're obviously if you're up for the tilt and you've read others, you'll know that that's what happens. You just get sucked in. Before we move on to any other major questions and delve right in, for those who are yet to read the book, there'll be no spoilers, but can you give us a quick rundown of what we are to expect if we jump in to the tilt?
Okay, this is one of the problems, of course, talking about a new crime fiction book, is you can't really talk about it too much because you don't want to give away spoilers. But the setting is very important in this book, as it is in many of my books. You can hear me now? Oh, good. So what I was saying is one of the problems about talking about a new crime fiction book is you can't talk too much about it because you don't want to give away spoilers for the people who haven't read it. But here's a kind of a setup for it. The setting is very important in this book, as it is in most of my books, and it's a real setting this time. It's the Barmah-Millawa Forest. It's the largest river red gum forest in the world, and it sits up on the Murray River just upstream from Echuca. So it's flooding at the moment. Now, what happens is a prologue. So this is the first few pages of the book, so it's not really a spoiler. It's midnight in the forest in the middle of winter, and there are two people out in the forest. There's a woman, an anonymous woman, intent on destroying one of the little dams, the regulators that keep the Murray from flowing into the forest. She wants to blow it up to let the water flow. Meanwhile, not far away, there's a man, again unknown, who's running for his life. He's being hunted down by men with guns. Are these two events connected? Well, you don't really know. By the end of the book, you might know, but not at the start. And that's a setup. Then what happens, the contemporary story at least, and I'll explain that in a minute, but the contemporary story starts about 3 months later. And we're with the two police detectives, Neil Buchanan and Ivan Lukic, who were the point of view characters in Treasure and Dirt. Don't worry, if you haven't read Treasure and Dirt, it doesn't matter. You can read this as a standalone book. They're sent down because the woman was successful in blowing up that regulator, and there's been a work crew there fixing it, and lo and behold, they find a body. Now, Nell is a little bit miffed about being sent down. It's one of her first investigations as a fully fledged homicide detective, for two reasons. One, it's really obvious the body has been there for decades. So she thinks it's destined for the cold case file, that all the forensic evidence is gone, any witnesses, probably the killers, they're probably all dead by now. But the other reason she's reluctant to be there is because she grew up nearby, her parents still live in a town nearby, and she's got a very strained relationship with them, particularly with her mother. So then what happens is Ivan leaves because he thinks it's a pretty much a tick and file investigation as well. But then things start stepping up. More bodies start emerging in the forest. Neil is threatened with violence and then experiences violence. And then to make matters worse for her, she begins to suspect that members of her own family are implicated in the murders. And so that's if you like, one way I can set up the book for you.
That's it, no more. No. You mentioned Nell Buchanan, and as you said, that she was a secondary point of view character in Treasure and Dirt, with Ivan being sort of your main line, and then the two of them working together. Did you know while you were working on Treasure and Dirt that Nell was going to come well into the limelight and be the main point of view character, or was she, did she develop into a point of view character as you went on?
That's interesting that you think in Treasure and Dirt that Nell is a sort of more subordinate character to Ivan. I'm not sure I would agree with it. I can see why you might think that. I'm not sure I'd agree with it.
Maybe just when they're set up because she came in as his assistant to the investigation, he took that dominant role,
Yeah, you meet him for before. So what I was thinking, I'd written the three earlier books, Scrubland, Silver, and Trust, and they feature a journalist, Martin Skarsten, and his partner, Mandalay Blonde. But for various reasons, I thought, I'll give these guys a rest. They deserve a rest. They've been through a lot. I'll write a standalone book, you know, which was Treasure and Dirt. But what happened is the characters, Ivan and Nell, got under my skin, and I thought there's more to them. Nell in particular is a really appealing character. She's very feisty. She's resilient. She doesn't take any shit. On the other hand, she's quite vulnerable, and she finds herself getting in, you know, difficult sort of emotional circumstances. So she's actually a really good character to have in a book, and hence, so it wasn't planned, but as I was writing Treasure and Dirt, I was proceeding, there's more to these guys, so yeah.
Yeah, that's really exciting, and especially Nell, as you say, she's not a usual stereotypical female cop. You know, she has got that out the back of Burke attitude, and that really comes through in the fact that you do see that strength and vulnerability run alongside together in The Tilt is really captivating. Off the, you've written what now, 5 books in as many years. Are you a planner or a pantser, as they would say? Plan out what you're going to talk about, or are you just blind by the seat of your pants as these books evolve?
Yeah, so that's the two crime writing camps, the plotters and the pantsers. And some of the plotters are really meticulous. There's this guy in America called Elroy Jones. He'll write a treatment of 300 or 400 pages before he starts writing the narrative, before he starts writing the book we all read. Jane Harper is a plotter, she'll do 100 pages or so. I'm a pantser. I start and I don't really know where I'm going. I wish I was a plotter. It sounds so much more efficient to me. But every time I try, I start writing and then I get a better idea. And I start veering away at tangents. That's how I write. And as a result, I often write myself into blind alleys. I end up throwing away stuff, restarting, you know, rewriting. So by the time I get my best possible manuscript to the publisher, it's probably on draft, I don't know, 10 or 12. It doesn't mean that every draft's a complete rewrite. But yeah, the books very much evolve over time.
To that, so The Tilt, like your previous, have got a couple of storylines running through it, and the same with the Scrubland trilogy and Treasure and Dirt, there's always more to it. The difference with The Tilt is that we are spanning close to 100 years in timelines. How did you, if you're a pantser, how did you keep up?
Okay. to explain what Hannah means with that is, there are 3 point of view characters in The Tilt, and one is Nell, and she's the contemporary timeline. So she's conducting the investigation. But there's 2 other characters. One is a young boy called Jimmy. He's aged 11. It's the Second World War, and the area is in the grip of a severe drought. And this is historically accurate. There was a very severe drought in southeastern Australia in the Second World War.
And so he is tasked with taking the family cattle into the forest where there's feed and where they can water from the Murray River. And he camps in there with the cattle aged 11. The second timeline is a teenage girl, age 15. She lives on a farm on the tilt above the forest. And it's a very different forest for her. And I can talk more about that. The reasoning behind that, if you like, is in Treasure and Dirt, you've got the two point of view characters. I'm Ivan and Nell, the two detectives. But it becomes clear by the end of the book that the crime they're investigating on the present day is rooted in events that took place in the past, maybe 7 years before, maybe 20 years before. So to find out what happened back then, they need people to tell them. And that's quite a lot of exposition. And you've got to be careful there because it can really drag the pace of the book down if being told a lot. And there's an odd bit of advice that writers are often given, and that's show, don't tell. And so that book, in a way, was doing a lot of telling by the end. So I had to work really hard with that to keep the pace up. And I think I did. I think Treasure and Dirt works. But I thought with this one, I'd try a different aspect because as the book was developing, it was obvious that the events of today were sort of set in motion years ago. So that body I'm talking about in the Regulator, it's clear from the start it's been there for decades. So what happened decades ago? So this time I thought, instead of having people tell Nell, that they would tell their own stories. And so the reader would be able to see the story of Jimmy and the story of Tessa. Now, that was quite difficult, as you say. At the start of the book, their stories seem totally separate. But as the book goes on, it's almost like their fates are colliding over the years. Now, to get that right, so there's less exposition, but to get it right, to have the three time frames flowing and sort of interweaving is quite difficult. So the book, you don't have, the first third of the book, Jimmy, second third of the book, Tessa, third part of the book, Nell. It's not like that. It's a chapter from one, a chapter from the other. And so for the reader, the kind of revelations in one storyline informs the way you read the other storylines. So in some parts, you might know more about what's going on than, say, Nell does, because you know what happened in the Second World War or what happened in the 70s. So to weave them together, so the revelations in one storyline coincides, if you like, with the progress in the other storylines is quite difficult. And what I didn't want to do is to have one character, if you like, kind of treading water, waiting for the others to catch up. So I took a lot of rewriting to get the pace of the three stories, all of them very strong. So I started writing them interwoven, then I'd go back and just concentrate on one storyline as if it was a self-contained story, and then back again. So there was a lot of backwards and forwards, but hopefully when you're reading the book, you don't notice any of that. the hope is that you were just immersed in the book, in the story.
Well, he definitely has nailed that. You felt you get to say the end of Jimmy's statement chapter, and all of a sudden you want to just keep reading so that you see what happens next? How does that going to tie in? And it does, and I think you've done that so well, how it propels that storyline through, that you know that you need to go keep reading to get the next piece of the clue, which is in a different way to your usual crime novels. Now, obviously in a past life, you were a journalist, and you've actually written a non-fiction book called The River about this exact area where the Tilties and also the Riverland where Scrubland started. How much of your time that you spent researching up there has actually impacted your fiction writing?
Depends on the book. So Treasure and Dirt I really didn't know anything about opal mining. So I was going to set treasures in one of those big global mines way out in the desert somewhere with fly in, fly out workers. I thought that was perfect because if any someone got murdered, it couldn't be someone from outside. It had to be someone working in the mine. And I was planning to go to South Australia, to Roxby Downs, and the Flinders Ranges, because I've never been there, and it looked like a nice place to go. And then COVID hit, and I couldn't get across the borders. I live in Canberra, and I couldn't get into Victoria or South Australia or Queensland, but I could get into New South Wales, because, you know, you just can't close the border between Canberra and New South Wales. I was wondering what I was thinking, maybe I could go to Broken Hill, but then I saw a woman wearing a pendant at the shop, like an opal pendant. I went, oh, an opal mining town, that'd be great. So I had to go, and so I went to Lightning Ridge, just up under the Queensland border. That was perfect. But you're dead right, with the tilt, it goes back to a book I wrote. It was published in 2010. Non-fiction book, they call it narrative non-fiction, and it was about the Murray-Darling Basin. And I travelled from the headwaters up in Queensland all the way through, you know, New South Wales, Victoria, South Australia, down to where the Murray enters the ocean. And the river at that point was in absolute crisis. It was the height of the millennial drought. So I went to one town out on the Hay Plain, a little town called Wakul. It was an irrigation town, and it had no water. The river was bone dry. So that was what, the town doesn't look anything like the town in Scrublands, but that was the basis for it. And that's what those towns have in common. You imagine that, an irrigation town, totally dependent on water, but with no water. And another place I went was the Barmer Millewa Forest, because there was no water being let into the forest at all, because there were fears that Adelaide was going to run out of drinking water. It was so touch and go there. And so the forest was dying. There were real fears that it would not survive that drought, particularly out on the edges. The big trees there can survive, you know, several years without water, but they really, really need a flood at least every 3 or 4 years, and they hadn't had one for at least a decade. So I went there, and it was completely drought stricken, and, you know, there was concerns it could be bushfires, and but I met an environmentalist there who was describing what it was like in the natural state of the forest, all the droughts and the weirs and the dams and the irrigation schemes. Then it's not really, it's a forest 9 months of the year, but in a typical year it's a wetlands for 3 months. After the winter rains and the spring snow melt, the forest would flood. That's how it's created and that's how it's sustained. And to describe what it was like when it was in flood. So imagine like the Florida Everglades, but with no alligators and towering gum trees. And you can take them and go through it in a canoe. And look, I really found it difficult to imagine. But that's what it's like now. The whole forest is flooded now. They'd be letting as much water into the forest as they possibly could to relieve Pechuca, where the capacity and the Goulburn rivers are sending floodwaters in. I went there in November and saw it. I tried a few times and COVID prevented me, but it was quite magical and so totally different from the way I remembered it during the drought. I'd already thought this would be a good setting for the book. And it lends itself to those three timelines, because the forest in the three timelines is very different. When Jimmy, the young boy, is there during the Second World War, it's almost like an industrial place. There are commercial fishers, there are loggers, there are people grazing cattle, there are people running horses. There's a sleeper cutters, so the red gum is incredibly hard and water resistant. So the railways of British India were built on the sleepers coming out of Barmer Millewa. More than a million were sent to India. And there's also this really interesting industry called the charcoal. So in the Second World War, Australia wasn't self-sufficient with oil and petroleum. We had to import it. I mean, we still do. But of course, the shipping lanes were in danger. Most of the petrol was being reserved for the military and vital services. But someone had worked out you can run cars and trucks off charcoal. You warm it up and it emits a gas, which I guess is methane, and you can burn it. And it's not nearly as efficient as petrol, but you can run a car on it. So there were men in the forest burning charcoal. And the thing about being on the charcoal, as they call it, is that after you did it for a day or two, you're absolutely black from top to toe and unrecognisable. So the men on the charcoal, there were all sorts of scoundrels. There were fugitives, there were escaped prisoners, there were draft dodgers and deserters. And really the authorities didn't mind too much because they needed the charcoal for the war effort. Now, I learned all this when I was writing that book, or I learned some of it, because I met an old man called Tim Mannion who recounted to me the story, and it's in the river. And when he was aged 11, during the drought, during the Second World War, he had to take the family cattle in the forest to feed. So that's, and then I did some more research as I was writing until I found some old histories of the area. The story of Jimmy in the book is not Tim's story. Again, Tim was just a seer of the idea of taking the cattle into the forest. Oh, the other thing in the forest at that point were there were Italian prisoners of war in there, set to work to cut trees and supply the charcoal and whatever. The storyline in the 70s is much more from my own imagination. I'm not quite as old as the girl Tessa in the book, but very similar age. And I've got a big brother and a big sister. And it's based a little bit on my own memories and the memories of the music of the era. Yeah, so, well, that's interesting. So different people have different favourites on the storyline. So I didn't have to research that too much. And of course, Neil's story now, I went back to the forest, I saw what it's like. And
it's fascinating. The Whitlamiers and the music there, Billy Thorpe sing along, my favourite bit in there. Now, if you're a Chris Hammer reader, you know that each book has a map. Where did the maps come from?
Thank you for bringing up the maps. Because I've just realised this recently. Some e-readers don't have the map in them, and audiobooks don't, and that's a problem. But if you just Google me on my website, all the maps are there, and you can click them and print them off and that. So if you're an audiobook listener or something, you can still get the maps, right? So the maps almost happen by accident. So most crime writers are writing a lot more than appears in the book. I've already told you about the plotters and how they do a big treatment before they start writing. But even us pantsers are going to have stuff in the background. So some writers write kind of backstories for their characters, so they really understand their characters and they get consistent through the book. Another thing that most writers are going to have is some sort of timeline. So you know where all the characters are where. You know, so the murderer isn't in. Yeah, so the town in Scrublands is a fictional town. The setting is real. And I was writing it while I had a full-time job and whatever. So just to make sure that the geography didn't shift, I started drawing a map, you know, so the pub didn't change sides of streets. Or if it took Martin to 3 minutes to walk from the motel in chapter one, it wouldn't take him half an hour in chapter 15. So it was just for my own reference. But by the time I finished the book and I had an opportunity to send it to a literary agent, I thought, oh no, I'll put the map in and see what they think. And then the publisher liked the idea, and we had a few attempts at getting the maps right. And we got a cartographer to do it, but they were lost because for a cartographer, accuracy is everything. And there was nothing to be accurate about. So
Jane, my publisher, found this artist, Alex Potocnik. He lives in Melbourne now. He just moved to Melbourne from Slovenia. And so all these examples of his work were like Dubrovnik and Split and little towns in the Balkans. He'd never been to an Australian country town. So I had to supply him pictures, you know, this is what a pub looks like. These are what wheat silos look like. You know, that, that whole thing. Anyway, he's done a fantastic. He was very relieved with this one when I said it was based on a real place, because that meant he could go and look at Google Maps and see, get the shape of it. I have fictionalised the towns around Barma Milowa. A couple of reasons for that. One is so I don't get sued. Yeah. If it's a small country town and you say, you know, the mayor is corrupt or the police is on the take or, you know, the news agent is a serial killer or something, you might get in trouble. But also I've changed the characteristics of some of the towns. So the town in the book, Toulon, is in the location of the real world town of Fowra. But in the book there's a big like wrecking yard, car wrecking yard, and that's not there in the real town. So it's a sort of a mix of the real and the imagined.
And also with the tilt we get a family tree as well, which is very high, referred to quite a lot.
Okay, so do you have your book here?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, okay, one. Just pass it up. I want to show them something. No, just the book. Okay, so if you look carefully, you can see there's a yellow stripe down the side. And on the back it says October, which means the book's being published in October. So Hannah hasn't read the finished book. She's read an uncorrected proof. Mic drop. And so you probably saw a few typos in there, right? So
I didn't say anything.
In the reason I bring that up, in the uncorrected proof, there's two family trees. There's one at the start and there's one at the end. In the end, we thought it was confusing. So there's a map at the front that you can refer to. There's a family tree at the end, but the reason it's at the end is because it contains spoilers. So please, as you read it, don't, unless you're that sort of reader, don't have a family tree in the back until you're finished. I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah, I knew there was a change to it there, and but it is very handy at the end because then you can sit there and go, oh, yes, right? Yeah, oh, all that coming. Yeah. Not really, I saw nothing. What are we going for time? Or a couple more, I reckon we can get in. So you were in maps and obviously your research on the river. Do you think the time as a journalist changes how you've written fiction to just your run-of-the-mill, always written fiction writers?
There's quite a few former journalists who became crime fiction authors. So Michael Robotham, Peter Temple, Jane Harper, Michael Connelly, Val McDermott, the list goes on. And there are some advantages as to having been a journalist. One is just the discipline of writing. You know you don't have to wait, or you shouldn't wait for inspiration to write, because if you did that as a journalist, you'd just be sacked, right? And I think I'll file a story today, Mr. Editor, because I'm not feeling inspired. And in fact, I find rather than getting inspired and writing, I'll start writing and then the inspiration comes as a process. And sometimes it's the days when I least feel like it. Man, suddenly I get a really good idea and it really starts flowing. That's one advantage. Another advantage, I think, is you appreciate and understand editing and being edited. So and editing isn't as creative as when you're actually writing the drafts. And I think a lot of writers almost resent the editing process. And it's understandable. You pour your heart and your soul into a book for 4 or 5 years, and a publisher then goes, oh, can we just change all of that? And people are resistant. I work with some of the best editors in Australia. So, and that makes it a better book for the readers a better experience. That's great. You know, so I embrace that. And part of that comes from, I think I've got probably a better sense of dialogue. I remember one author saying that the two most difficult things to write are sex scenes and dialogue. And I absolutely agree with sex scenes, but dialogue I enjoy writing and often takes me in unexpected places. And I think that's because I used to transcribe a lot of interviews, or when I was working in Canberra, listening to politicians in question time or a press conference, you know, I'm listening for that grab, that soundbite that goes on the news. And you realise that people do not speak dramatically. In fact, it's part of the magic of the human mind that we start a sentence without knowing what words we're going to use or how we're going to end the sentence. And if that's correct for a sentence, it's absolutely correct for a conversation. We don't plan out our conversations, right? We don't have an agenda. We start, we meet someone for coffee or we're sitting around the dinner table, and who knows where the conversation is going to lead to. And that's what I find when I'm writing the dialogue. I try and find all the natural. And sometimes it just spins off into ridiculous places and it's no good. But sometimes it takes me somewhere, you know, somewhere really worthwhile. There are the advantages. There are disadvantages, particularly if you've been a daily news reporter. I spend a lot of my time doing feature writing and like long-form television reporting, and that's different. You need to more tell a story then. The typical newspaper story or TV news, you have the most important fact first.
Yeah.
More floods are expected in central Victoria. Second most important fact, you know, the valleys of the Goulburn, Campaspe, Murray are expected to flood. Third most important fact, authorities are warning people not to travel. So it's a series of information. It's not a story. And you've got to tell a story in a book. You can't start with the most important fact. You've got to start with once upon a time. And the other problem with journalism, the language is often really hackneyed, cliched, but it's a very useful for news reporting. You know, the government is going to backflip on tax cuts. We all understand what that means, but you can't put that sort of hackneyed language in a novel, because what you want to do with a novel is invite people in to a different world. Doesn't matter whether it's crime fiction or whatever sort of fiction. And so you want to bring them in and almost like cast a spell. And if you start using cliched and hackneyed language, it's going to break the spell. So journalism definitely has some advantages, but also some disadvantages, things you definitely need to unlearn.
Before we throw it, we'll take some audience questions as well. Obviously after reading all of your books, I'm sure there's plenty of people here as well wondering, one, will Martin and Mandalay make a reappearance, or has a new character piqued your interest while writing the tilt? Or both?
Probably both. I think... Yeah, I'm pretty sure that Martin and Mandalay will come back at some stage. Martin has a sort of a cameo appearance in Treasure and Dirt, and again in The Tilt, because if Ivan and Nell are going to talk to a journalist, why would I invent a new journalist when I've got a perfectly good one just sitting there? I think there's more for them to go. All my books, there's the crime stories and the puzzles, but there's also the personal story and the protagonists. They've always got skin in the game. They're always affected by what's unfolding. I mean, Treasure and Dirt, both Nell and Ivan, for separate reasons, their jobs are on the line and they're affected by what happens in the investigation. So again, in The Till, Nell's relationship with her family changes over time. So I need some more storylines like that for Mark and Mandy, but they'll come back. But I'm already thinking of the next book. I've already started working on it, and it's going to be Ivan and Nell again, and maybe a little more emphasis on Ivan in this one, because he very much takes a bit of a back seat in The Till.
Yeah, you're wondering what he's doing. Where is he? He's always thinking, Ivan, so they can't have just been out on holiday.
If you find out, let me know.
Well, thank you very much. I am happy to take some audience questions, and then you'll be able to purchase if you haven't already, and Chris will be staying to do some book signing as well. Do we have any questions? Yes. Do you want to, Yara, are you able to take the
help?
Make sure it's actually running, otherwise you might have to. Questions? This lady over the back, pop your hand up again.
I just wonder if you said you spend so long rewriting books and thinking about characters, and then, I'm sorry, I don't know your
name. Hannah.
You read the book in 2 days?
Yeah.
How do you feel? I mean, you pass this spell all going in, which is good, I suppose, but all this time you spent reading the book.
No, that's marvellous. So, and I hope you know, I might spend a year writing a book, but it'd be very disappointing if you only read one book in a year. In fact, it's quite the compliment when someone says, I read the book in a day or 2 days or something, because I'm thinking, oh, it's worked. If people are labouring to get through the book, then you think, okay, the spell hasn't quite worked properly. No, that's actually a great compliment.
I think that sort of relates to cooking a meal. You might spend hours doing a meal and it's over in 5 minutes, but you're glad everybody enjoyed it. My question is naming the characters. It's a bit like I always think it's sort of you try and name your children, and then when you've got the name, they become that, they couldn't be anything else. And so I find names in books really interesting as to why you name them this and not that. How do you come up with names?
So the question for those who didn't hear it was, how do I come up with the names for the characters? And, you know, if you read my books, you know, some of the character names are pretty eccentric. They're a bit Dickensian. And that really happened. I'd written the 2 non-fiction books, which I really loved doing. I learned 3 things. 1, I could write a book. 2, I really enjoyed writing books. And 3, there's no money in writing books. And after I read, I had to go back and get a real job again, right? And that's the reality for most authors in Australia. The average annual income for a published author in Australia is about $12,000 a year, which means people are you know, holding down full-time jobs, most of the time looking after young children, and then trying to write a book in their spare time. And that's what I was doing in the book that became Scrublands. And my expectation was, I thought maybe I could write a fiction book that was good enough to get published, but that would be, you know, I'd get my $12,000 or whatever and go back to my day job. So I think I just got a bit bored and started putting in these eccentric names into Scrublands, like Martin Scarston and Mandalay Blonde and Harley Snouch and Codger Harris and so forth. Morris Montefiore, and so the list goes on. And they do become distinct characters. Sometimes late in editing, a character's name will change. So the priest in Scrublands is called Byron Swift, another kind of rather distinctive name. And there was another character I called Bryce. I can't even remember which one it was now. But the American editors said they don't sound the same, but they look a bit the same on the page. Both start with B and both have Y's in them. That might be confusing. So sometimes they do get changed late in the process for that sort of reason. But then when Scrublands came out and was this big success, I was feeling a bit awkward about that, all these really a bit over-the-top names. Although if it wasn't working, I'm sure my editors would have tried to pull it back a bit. But I was still feeling a bit sheepish, but then someone said, oh, look, your books typically have 3 or 4 different storylines in them, which is true. And then really the distinctive names are really good because it helps me remember who's who. And I thought, oh, well, that's, I'm like that as a reader. You put a, if you're reading a book on a weekend and then get busy and pick it up the next weekend, some of the characters, it's, oh, who is that again? Or a character isn't, doesn't appear for 100 pages or something like that. And then, of course, there's a lot of returning characters in my book. So Ivan Lukic is actually in the first three books. He's just a very minor character. He's a rather surly offsider to the main police person, Maurice Montefiore. That's another one, Maurice Montefiore. So I thought, well, I can't have all the new characters with sort of plain vanilla names and all the continuing characters with these sort of eccentric, distinctive names. So I thought I'd lean into it. So, you know, in Treasure and Dirt, there's a guy who runs an earth-moving sort of equipment shop, and his name's Trevor Topsoil.
Actually, I love the eccentric names because it's you. I mean, I get sick of the same Sarahs and Janes and things that are in every other book you read. So it's really great, but that wasn't the question. Have you a daily routine for writing?
Okay, the question is, do I have a daily routine? So when I was writing Scrublands, it was stolen hours late at night. But now I've got the great privilege of being a full-time author. That's how I can do a book a year, because I don't have a proper job. I write pretty much every morning. It's not self-discipline, it's because I'm more or less addicted to it. I love doing it. I'm very fortunate, I think, because of my history as a travelling journalist, I can pretty much write anywhere. On trains and planes and airports and in cafes or a library or something. So I typically write in the morning. I run out of steam after 3 or 4 or 5 hours, and then I'll do admin work or, you know, the shopping, or I do exercise, which is important if you're sitting for long periods of time. But then as the year goes on, the book evolves. It's consuming me more and more. So I might be out for a walk, or I might be swimming, or I might be driving, but it's almost occupying my mind until at the end of the process, it's, you know, I'm sort of almost living in it. Still maybe only writing, editing I can do for a longer period, because it's a different, there's a saying, you write with your heart and you edit with your brain. And that's true when you're writing, you're kind of in the story. When you're editing, you're trying to be more objective. Yeah. Will the readers understand what's going on here? Is this bit a bit slow? Have I brushed over this bit too quickly? That sort of thing. But you pretty much work in the mornings, and then if I have to edit later on.
I just want to know why some countries change the names of authors' books.
Okay, so the question is, why do some countries change the names of authors' books? Thank you for bringing that up, because that's what's happened with my books. The first three, Scrubland, Silver and Trust, are the same everywhere in English, obviously different names in different languages. But I've got a new editor in the UK, and they've changed the names of Treasure and Dirt to Opal Country, and the tilt when it's published in January will be called Dead Man's Creek. So if you see Dead Man's Creek for sale on the internet, don't buy it, because the cover and the title are different, but inside it's absolutely identical. And they do it because they think it will appeal to their readers more. So with Opal Country, it makes sense. We perhaps don't realise it so much living here, but foreigners really identify Australia with opals. Oh, you're going to Australia, make sure you buy some opals. Well, you know, the international airport or the duty-free stores are opals for sale. And so by putting that on a cover with a sort of red dirt image and a broken windmill or something, the UK reader would immediately, and people typically look at book covers for about a second, that's what the market research says, they go, oh, it's an Australian crime book. And that's really what they're trying to do. And I'm actually fine with it, except for the confusion of its readers. Because I figure they just know their markets better than a foreigner like me ever could. But, yeah.
I think one of the things that I really Australian, you can really relate to the area that you're writing. You get right into it. I mean, I grew up in the outback, I can relate to Southland, and I've been to the forest, and I can relate to the forest and the changes that you, you know, present in the Barmah forest and the changes. But I find that that's really, for me, that's really part of the depth of the story, is that I can relate to the areas that you're talking about.
So the question was more of a comment really saying, that she can identify with the settings and that she appreciates the Australian settings. Look, I do too. There's some authors attempted to write books, say, set in the United States, because it's a much bigger market. You know, if you crack it there, you make a lot of money. I'm not really interested in doing that. What I find fascinating is it's not just Australians who like the settings and identify with them. It has an appeal for people in Europe and the UK. And, you know, Australia is an interesting and for them a rather exotic place. So, you know, the history of the forest that I described during the Second World War, I know already from the English are going, there were Italian prisoners of war in Australia. It's like, you know, when they hear that there's snow in Australia or something like that. So they're interested in another way. And it's probably like us, we read a Scandinavian book or a book like Anclive Shetland series, and we may never have been there, but we still love the settings.
Any
other questions?
Yes,
I wonder
if you use a whiteboard tool to plot what's happening at any time.
Okay, so the question is, do I use a whiteboard? And that goes back to what I was saying, that there's always stuff in the background if you're running a project. I use a, if you like, a digital kind of version of that. Because I was a journalist for 30 years, I basically was typing, right, you know, even before we had computers in the newsroom, I had to type and then I went straight to screens. So, and working to be big screens. So I'm used to just doing that process, but doing it digitally. There's a program that some writers use called Scrivener that they say is really, really good and effective. I haven't used that because I've already developed my own method. So I'll have tables in Word documents, or I'll have a spreadsheet with all different, you know, timelines and facts and word counts and all, you know, where characters are and all sorts of things. But yeah, that's all in the background, and it's just a way of making sure that the narrative is as effective as it can be.
I've got a question.
Yeah.
Have you ever wanted to or been encouraged to make any of your books into
the
film,
by
the movie or film?
Okay, so the question is, have I been approached to have any of my books made into film or TV series? Yeah. So even before Scrublands was published, it was optioned for television. Now, this is a very long process, but it's good news. It looks like it's going to go ahead. It's being developed by a fantastic Australian production company called Easy Tiger. They're the company behind the Jack Irish series of music.
Wow.
And behind Rake and behind them. So it's in very good hands. It's being developed in conjunction with Stan and Channel 9. I think the idea would be on the streaming service first and then go to free-to-air. I'll believe it when I see it. But they tell me it's going. And just the other night I ran into someone and she said, oh, my friend has been hired to cast it. So if they're up to that stage, it must be pretty close to going ahead. So, and when I met the principal of the production company all those years ago now, this is even before Scrublands was published. The first question he asked was, will there be more Martin and Mandy books? And you could see already the intention was if they make one and it's successful, then they can, instead of that long, drawn-out process of getting finance and people interested and all that, they can just renew for another season. So I'm really hoping that's what happens. Who knows whether it does, it's in the lap of the gods.
Who do you reckon will play the master?
No idea. Martin's actually not really described in Scrum, as I realised later, because it's told from his point of view. There's a scene where he's looking in the mirror, but he doesn't describe himself, because when you look at yourself in the mirror, you know what you look like. You don't describe yourself. You notice what's a bit different. So he's looking bloodshot, and he's a bit sunburned, and he needs a shave. It's all those sort of more ephemeral things. But that's good. That means whoever plays him. The trouble is, I know that 90% of people are going, no, that's not what he looks like. Because if we went around the room and asked everyone, what does Martin look like? I guarantee there'll be a huge variety in how people imagine him. But that's one of the magic of books, right? I think I've written this thing set in stone, but it's not, of course. It only comes alive in the imagination of the readers, and all readers are going to imagine it, the same story in a different way. So, yeah, no, I'd be very interested to see who gets going. I don't really mind too much what he looks like. I just hope that they cast an Australian actor.
Oh, yes.
Well, make sure John Waters is in there somewhere.
Okay. Yeah, John Waters.
Definitely
Roger. I did a panel like this not long ago with the actor Brian Brown. He's written a short series of short stories called Sweet Jimmy, like Prime Things. So someone stood up and asked him whether he was available to play Codger Harris. He wasn't too sure about that suggestion.
That's brilliant. Now I'm going to be thinking about that the rest of the day. I'm going to be doing the whole casting. That's a casting I know.